evening and welcome to the Vigilante Dialogues. I am your host, Shayna Smith, welcoming you back to our show and wishing everyone a happy new year. I pray it's an epic one. So to start off the year, I hope we have a very vibrant discussion this evening. We're going to be doing a year in review for 2016 and looking forward into 2017 as far as, you know, expectations, what we like to see more of, what we like to see less of. So tonight, joining me in the National Boardroom, I have Dr. Natalia Wheatley, who is a lecturer at our community college at Parakeet Aviv. Dr. Wheatley, I think this is the first time you're here at the National Boardroom.
Yeah, the first time.
It is welcome.
An honor and a privilege. Thank you for inviting me here. Happy New Year to you.
Yes. Thank you.
I'm very excited to be here with you this evening. I'm sure it's going to be a fantastic discussion.
Yeah, and you know, I always going to be too short. I'm going to sit out front
because I know
there's so much to go over and look at and talk about. But you know, while I was preparing for the show, I started to think about, you know, what are the top three things or in terms of highlights that I reflected on for the year, and, you know, what are some of the things as far as concerns that I saw and may still be concerned about. So it's going to be really straightforward discussion today, but because it's so many things, we're going to run the gamut. So we see how much we can cover and, you know, put out there for the public to contemplate, as it were, in terms of our national development, because that's always been one of the focuses of our shows as far as connecting everything that we do talk about around, you know, how it affects the national development of our country and moving forward as a society. So let's start at the top. So for you, the Beacon did a nice year in review in their last edition before the year closed out. So they have in there like the breakdown by month, but we don't have to go through month by month. What would be some of the top, you know, highlights for you that happened, whether local or regional or even international?
Well, absolutely at the top of the list has to be the Panama Papers. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Panama Papers made headlines everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, it was actually international news and local news everywhere. Like, it was on the 6 o'clock news in, you know,
every major
Europe,
city,
every major city, every major town.
Yeah.
And that's not really the way we want the BVI to be on the map.
Yeah.
So that was absolutely the number one, I would say, story for the year 2016, with implications into 2017. Mm-hmm. You want me to list some of the other ones? We had the NHI came into effect in 2016, and as you know, that was something that was controversial. It's a big initiative, and it came into effect in 2016, and as most people describe, had some teething pains and some different issues associated with it. That was a big one.
Okay.
We also had the introduction of a 12th grade.
Yes, we did have that.
And that was interesting because for the first time, and I think probably since the beginning of the high school, we didn't have a high school graduation. And we had 12th grade students up at the HLSCC campus doing their CAPE subjects, dual enrollment at HLSCC, and other things that they're being introduced in the 12th grade. So that's interesting. One thing right at the end of the year, we had a real terrible situation with crime. And we had a few other incidents of crime throughout the year. One of my former students, Nikira Smith, you know, had a horrific murder, and you had some other examples of murders and things like that. Even though in some cases there weren't actually murders, there were, you know, reports of vehicles being sprayed with bullets and things like that. That's something that we really have to keep an eye on. And
basically, crime involving guns, a lot of gun violence,
something that we really have to keep our eyes on. So those were some of the things that I saw.
Well, for me, top of the list was, well, internationally, Brexit.
Absolutely. I forgot about Brexit.
That was a left field, you know.
A real surprise.
Yeah, big time. And even in all its glory, I would say, because remember now, right towards the end, just before they actually went to vote, there was the murder of the one legislator, the parliamentarian.
Yes.
That kind of marred the whole thing. And then the outcome was even more, you know, shocking.
Yeah.
I think for everybody.
And actually, you could see that the Brexit was almost like a sign of things to come in
with
terms
the US
of
US election.
Exactly. And yeah. Some of the nationalist movements basically that's going on almost as a response to globalization.
Yeah. And we're going to talk about that in terms of, you know, things coming up in 2017, because it's very interesting, you know, what those decisions indicate for a lot of countries, because it's reflecting a sentiment that is not unique to those specific jurisdictions as far as UK and US.
Absolutely.
So it's something for us to really pay attention to. And I think the other two I had was the Tortola Fair Park.
Yes.
Because that came on stream fully last year. And the talk of self-determination, the rhetoric about, because of coming out of the Panama Papers, triggered that conversation around constitutional reform and what, you know, what would be our next step as a country and where we see ourselves going. So I it was a very interesting year.
Absolutely.
In a lot of different areas and forums. So there's much to look forward to. The three concerns though I had, as far as top concern, would be starting off with in terms of government financial management.
I would agree with that.
I think that's something that basically lasted throughout the year.
Yeah.
As far as concern, whether it was public discussion or House of Assembly, you know, wherever, a kitchen table, I think was something that has been kind of like a front burner issue for quite some time. And one of the things I want to see us be, you know, to see more efficient systems put in place, because we should never be guessing about how much money we have, what we spent on,
yeah,
you know, where the money is going. And as taxpayers, we should be very concerned from a standpoint of, you know, accountability, because we need to know what's happening with taxpayer dollars.
Well, having said that, you know, that's something I really wanted to mention, the whole and it's been an issue recently about audited audited financial statements. The fact that we haven't had audited financial statements for the last 10 years is something of a concern.
Yeah.
And we have to be very careful in terms of how we deal with our finances, because it's good for accountability, it's good for transparency, because we have had a bad habit of passing a budget and not sticking to the budget, and even not coming to the House of Assembly when we've allocated a particular amount of money for a particular initiative or a particular project, and using that money for other reasons, or maybe going over, overspending our allocation.
Yeah.
And those type of things need to come to the House of Assembly to be voted on. And also we need audited accounts just to know exactly where we are. And as you say, the taxpayers need accountability.
Yeah.
And I think going into 2017, that it's, you know, it's been a buzzword recently, accountability, transparency, good governance.
Yeah, but we want them to go more than buzzwords. We need some activity around them.
Absolutely.
As far as what's happening. Because one of the questions that came to mind was about the Public Accounts Committee.
Yes.
That seems to have gone dormant.
Yeah, that's something that we really need to get going as much as possible. The Public Accounts Committee, as most persons would have known, because the PAC, as it's called, was in the news a lot during the whole cruise pair situation on Tortola Pair Park, especially early on when we had Tortola Port Partners.
Yeah.
There was an investigation into the early part of that project, and they were very active at that point. And it's very important. I would encourage the opposition strongly to get that going, because they have a lot of power. It's one of those measures put in there to ensure good governance, to make sure that we have checks and balances in our system.
Yeah.
As most people know, this is the Westminster system, gives a lot of power to the ruling party. And these are some of the ways in which we can ensure that we have checks and balances in the system.
Yeah. And I think, again, once we understand better, as we refer to it as a Westminster model, in terms of, you know, these different committees that are part and parcel of the House of Assembly structure and the role that they have to play in terms of bringing good governance.
Right.
And promoting transparency and accountability.
Right.
You know, it's very key for us going forward, I think. You know, even in terms of just strengthening ourselves.
Yeah.
Because I think one of the things that I see it out there as, you know, we have the financial protocols still in effect.
Yes.
Right? And what concerns me with those is that they don't have kind of like a expiration date to say, well, okay, after 10 years, you know, after you've gotten this list of things in place, then we'll, you know, revisit the types of financial controls that we have in place.
Right.
So it's always important for us to, you know, make sure that our financial management systems are as strong as possible. Mm. Whatever internal controls that we have, to make sure that we're proving ourselves, so to speak.
Yeah.
Because when it comes to things like needing capital to develop the country, you know, loans will always be a part and parcel of when it comes to cash management. Because even when as a business, you don't always have $1 million someplace to go and invest in your company. You have to go to the bank.
Absolutely.
But it's a matter of showing prudence that yes, I have been managing what I do have properly, so therefore, you know, you can rely on me to pay back my loan to be able to get those additional capital. So I think that's kind of the relationship now we have with the UK with these protocols, that we are being watched closely, and we have to make sure that we are doing above and beyond, I would say, what's expected of us.
Yeah, and there's been some indication of that. The governor, I believe, had some correspondence that went into the public sphere.
Yeah.
Through the media.
That got let out. Yeah.
And at various instances, he's made some statements about audited accounts and things like that. I agree with you completely. I think it behooves us to show that we are good stewards of our own finances, especially with the situation we have with the United Kingdom. Mm-hmm. We have a very interesting relationship, the overseas territories with the United Kingdom. Mm-hmm. They have reserve powers that they use in Turks and Caicos. They can dissolve our legislature in an instant and go into direct rule.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that they don't a measure they would not take lightly.
Yeah.
But they've already made indications that they're looking at us carefully.
Yeah.
And even despite the threat of direct rule, people want accountability and transparency because things are not what they used to be in the past when we had millions upon millions of dollars to play with. Our civil service has grown exponentially.
Expenses have gone up every
year. Have gone up. Our recurrent expenditure leaves little room for anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the capital projects, as you have rightly said, we needed loans to carry out.
Yeah.
And we have to manage our finances in such a way where we can meet our commitments. And something that was of concern to me is when the acting accountant general said in a report that we may not be able to meet some of the commitments with our cash flow. So it's something that we need to keep our eye on.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, Shayna, we have to have a discussion about the future of our economy.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have some indications that financial services is not performing as well as it
used to
in the past. And mm-hmm. and actually we've had a tremendous windfall from financial services. While our expenditure was growing every year, we were still able to keep pace because our revenue kept growing. Mm-hmm. And we have a big budget in compared to maybe 10 years ago, 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
We're up over, well over 300 million.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would say we've been lucky.
Mm-hmm.
Thus far, but we should have been preparing for financial services not performing
mm-hmm.
as well as it used to, and we really need a discussion about what is the economy of the future.
Yeah, and that's definitely one of the things I have on my 2017 list in right. terms of starting serious discussions around diversification of the economy.
Right.
You know, so even if it's still within the industry of financial services, what are the types of services that we will be offering? Because we do see a decline in certain areas, whether it's in corporations or registrations and renewals even, because, you know, the same December 22nd issue of the Beacon, half of the back of it was basically notices for liquidation.
Wow.
So it's always a kind of, I guess, a purging with the system that, you know, certain companies start to come off, and then the hope is that you'll have new registrations or renewals of other companies. But those are, for me, those little indicators that I pay attention to. Because there's one, you know, you might have 2 pages of notices earlier in the year, but then when you start to get down towards the end of the year and you see, you notice that, you know, so many ads have been taken off with notices for various reasons, but all of it around the financial services sector, that, you know, it's important for us to pay attention to those things. So that's why I always advocate. People talk about paper, the paper newspaper is going to go. No, because there, in there has things that we need to pay attention to that you're not going to find online.
Absolutely.
You know, so I always still try to pick up a paper once a week and see, you know, what's happening. Because that's the window to the society, basically.
You saw me with my big stack of papers.
Came here with a Bible and newspapers. But yeah, it's important, and I encourage, you know, everybody, young and old, they need to buy a newspaper and read the paper, because the paper has some interesting things in it that the headlines, the sensational headlines on the online papers don't necessarily communicate. And you need information to make, come to inform conclusions about what's happening in your society.
Well, I mean, I have to give credit to a newspaper like The Beacon. Mm-hmm. Because as you rightly said, the online news, they serve a purpose. You get quick news, you get instant news, and that serves a good purpose in the society. But when it comes to investigative journalism and things like that, I think The Beacon really does a fantastic job of that. And even just having a year in review like that, you know, I really appreciated it. Mm-hmm. But I'm glad that you brought up the whole media thing, because the media has been in and out of the...
The media.
The media, quote-unquote, attacks on the media has been in and out of the media.
Yeah.
And it brings to bear something that the governor has spoken about, and many of us have spoken about as well, which is the Freedom of Information Act. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to jump ahead of you, because I know...
Yeah, that's a 2017
2017.
But we did have conversations about it. I had the Chief Records Management Officer, Mr. Christopher Valak, on talking about the Archives and Record Management Unit and the importance of information to a society.
Right.
Because, again, it's not just about managing files, because I know when it first started, a lot of people had that misconception about it,
right,
as far as what they do. But, you know, again, we need information, and we need good information.
Yes.
You know, if we're going to run our country properly, these things have to be available to us. So, you know, those things are critical, even from the average citizen's perspective.
Yeah, and I know you know better than many. There are many boxes and boxes and boxes of reports and very good bits of information that people compiled. And I'm not sure if they were analyzed, probably analyzed even. And then it's just sitting down in a box in some basement somewhere.
Yeah. So I would like to see coming on stream with the new library. And I said we're supposed to be getting a new library location soon.
Yes.
So that it include the archives.
Right.
Because, you know, again, all of that is part of accessing information. But before we digress any further, just before we take a break, though, one of the other things around financial management that concern me is the number of lawsuits.
Oh, yeah. That is a huge one. We had some major lawsuits last year. Yeah.
And all of these things will affect cash flow.
Yes.
Because, you know, I don't know if people think we have all this money saved up.
Yeah, we have a huge lawsuit with the ports.
You get sued for $22 million. I think that was a global water. I don't remember if that the verdict came through with that. But, you know, their tag that they put on their lawsuit was, I think, over $20 million. And that's not money sitting anywhere. It means now that is going to be a monthly disbursement that doesn't go towards what we needed to really go towards.
Right.
To go and kind of like clean up our mess.
And things are already tight. And we had another big lawsuit with Customs and Delta.
Delta, yeah.
And that didn't go in our favor. No. And that was another huge one.
Yep.
So
yeah, we have, as part of all financial management strategy, in terms of lessons learned from last year, I hope we start doing those due diligence when it comes to our legal negotiations or agreements. I mean, you know, Global Water was a situation I think that could have been definitely avoided and handled differently.
Right.
You know, because it's like it's a contract that was entered into by previous administration, but then it's kind of like it got neglected until it got to the point where, you know, people are like, well, we're not going to be neglected anymore. And, you know, we're owed something here. And you know, this is what it comes up to. But it impacts us as far as, you know, again, the taxpayer and the students in the school, because, you know, resources aren't going to be available to go where it is they need to go.
And that type of thing is unacceptable from my standpoint. You have contracts signed by a previous administration. Mm-hmm. Doing nothing or ignoring it is not an option, because as you see, the taxpayers are on the hook for it. So when it comes to things like that, we have to be responsible. We can't be petty. And we have to have the people's best interests in mind, because
make the hard decisions.
Governments are continuums. You know, it's not as though we start over from scratch.
Exactly. Even though it has seemed like that sometimes in the past, but it has to be, there has to be a continuity of business, as you're saying. That's very
key. The Bywater contract came and we had to deal with it. Because there was no way out of it. We had to deal
the
with
obligation
it.
Was
we had to honor
there.
The contract.
Obligation. Or if we wanted to get out, we'd have to buy it out. And again, that would cost money.
Right.
You know, so it's we, in terms of our financial management strategy, I would like to hear, actually, because the budget speech is coming up soon. You know, something towards that, as far as, you know, how are we pivoting the way that we do business as government, and, you know, what are going to be some of the priorities to make sure that the systems are in place to manage the money to the best, you know, best possible level that we can.
And consider mediation. I mean, we don't have to be so aggressive and so hostile as it pertains to some of these things.
Oh, in terms of going to court.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But you want to make sure that your laws are enforced and your laws are respected. At the same time, you know, we have to do our due diligence and ensure that we have a sure case if we want to be that aggressive. If not, that try to some mediation.
Well, we have a new international arbitration center, so we may put it to use.
Yes, absolutely.
So that was one of the highlights from last year. But we're going to take a break now and get a word from our sponsors and be right back. Welcome back. You're tuned in to another episode of the Vigilante Dialogues. I'm your host, Shayna Smith. And with me this evening, I have Dr. Natalia Wheatley. And we've been doing a year-end review, talking about the highlights from 2016, concerns that we see, and looking at what we see happening in 2017 and beyond. So, Natalia, before we went from the break, we talked about some of the concerns that we have, and we were there talking a bit about the financial management systems with our government and the importance of being a good financial steward, is what I would say.
Of course.
Right? Because that's always important. I hear people talking a lot of discussion around who's in charge of what. But really, at the end of the day, the systems and the processes is what's going to dictate a lot of the outcomes. Eh?
Yeah, and how disciplined we are.
With what we do have.
Right.
Because it's like saying, if I have $10 and I say I'm not managing that $10 properly, but then I want $100, I'm not going to manage the $100 properly either.
Right.
You know, because the habit is not there. So there are certain things I like to see us definitely, you know, put in place, and it not necessarily, if there's indirect things that are affecting our money situation, like lawsuits, which we talked about.
Right.
So, you know, again, we need to do better in our contract management and administration.
Right.
To again, you know, stop the spending, that the unnecessary spending that's happening there, or unplanned for, because, you know, I can't plan for when the court might actually do a ruling, and then it's like, okay, you have to pay these people millions of dollars by XYZ time frame.
Right.
So it's difficult. We started talking about crime, in terms of especially the recent escalation, I would say, in criminal activity, and especially involving guns. That's really concerning to me. And, you know, I'd like to hear more about, in terms of, you know, from a national standpoint, not just from the police, but the National Security Council, as far as what plans are going to be put in place or are in place to mitigate the problem that we have, and to be proactive. Because, you know, I was thinking about this today, and I was like, you know what, we're gonna wait till when a visitor is injured or killed,
right.
and then be frantic, mm-hmm. you know, about we have to fix this, we have to fix this. But when I have friends and relatives that are being affected, you know, even losing loved ones
right.
through acts of violence, we already have a problem. What yeah. are your thoughts?
We have a huge problem. I agree with you. Crime is something that can cripple your economy.
Mm-hmm.
It can affect the security of your family, your friends, your loved ones.
Your business.
Your business, economic activity. As we've seen recently, I mean, we had someone recently he lost his life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very sad story. And I mean, nothing you can do will be able to comfort the family of that person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you say that crime in the BVI still isn't that bad, that's not going to comfort the person who just lost their loved one.
Mm-hmm.
And we actually as a community need to demand answers.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned the National Security Council, and I would say that I feel as though our leaders are too silent mm-hmm. on this issue.
Mm-hmm.
The business community, residents, mm-hmm. I'm sure visitors must have gotten wind.
Well, if they check in the news, they know what's happening too.
Yeah, and you know, you've seen certain websites would have certain areas that you should be careful of in the BVI already.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Crab, you know, they call Crab Lot, they call Long Look and mm-hmm. places like that. So mm-hmm. this is something that we need to take very seriously and arrest the problem, and we need solutions.
Yeah.
Even if we want to say that the governor on the United Kingdom is in charge of the crime situation, we need to demand results from them.
Yeah.
You know, because you know, as I said before, this thing can affect us very negatively.
It already is.
So we need to demand results from them. We have a new commissioner. We've had past two commissioners come here.
Mm-hmm.
We've said we had to bring them in because of their own expertise, their skills, their experience. But where's the results? When we have special constables coming from the United Kingdom, you know, where are the results? We need to see results. You know, if we're saying that these persons came with particular qualifications,
yeah.
in my opinion, it's not good enough just to say, well, the community is not speaking to us,
mm-hmm.
So there's nothing we can do. And I know there are things that they're doing, but the community would like to feel comfortable knowing that we're taking some measures that are leading to results.
Yeah, and I that's very key, again, in terms of, you know, the communication strategy, as far as saying, well, you know, the council has met, these are issues that we've identified,
right.
and what are solutions? Because, you know, it really, as a citizen, annoys me when all I hear is excuses.
Yeah.
We need this, we need that, we need that. So then why don't we have it?
Right.
And furthermore to that, well, when are we going to get it?
Because it's a priority.
This isn't something, again, we're going to wait, and we always tend to do this. We, you know, we have issues with a particular road, and it's not until a tourist gets into an accident that we run and we go fix it.
Yeah.
As if, you know, a resident or a Virgin Islander's life isn't as important.
Right.
You know, and I find that very distasteful.
Mm-hmm.
Because then it's like, you know, you're sending a very loud message to me without saying the words that, you know, you're a second class citizen to, you know, those that we might somehow deem more important. We should never do that.
Right.
You know, we're sending a very bad message and precedent when we do those things. So yeah, we need to get a hold of what's happening, because even going back to unsolved crime,
yeah.
and you know, we're to a point now where I don't see how, and I have to really see a strong argument, how we're gonna get the guns off the street and stop the trafficking of guns. So
we have, you know, porous borders.
Do we need to start having a conversation about gun legislation? Well, again, about gun legislation in regards to, you know, our law enforcement officers,
right?
And how we kind of balance the scales, because especially for the business community, you know, it's they're on attack.
Yeah, and it doesn't matter how many security guards you employ,
they don't have any protection.
If a criminal puts a gun to the head of a security mm-hmm. officer, and the security officer does not have any means of defending themselves, I would advise the security to follow their directions mm-hmm. because, I mean, who knows what happened in this last situation, whether, you know, the brother that lost his life resisted or whatever. I'm not sure what the situation was. Mm-hmm. But when someone, a criminal, has a weapon, you're at a serious disadvantage.
Yeah.
And depending on their temperament is whether you mm-hmm. walk out of there with your life. So yeah. I agree with you. I lived in the United Kingdom for 3 years in London, mm-hmm. and I saw special constables with weapons all the time. So this whole concept that we're being sold by the Commissioner of Police and the Governor about having weapons, it doesn't apply to the United Kingdom, because the United Kingdom, every officer doesn't have a weapon,
mm-hmm.
but they have a great multitude of officers
yeah.
who have weapons, and depending on the trouble spots that they're in London, mm-hmm. you see them brandishing weapons quite obviously.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I understand the arguments against arming.
There's always going to be pros and cons, but we have a serious problem where, you know, we're saying the criminal element has the guns, and then mm-hmm. the law enforcement, it's more limited, because
yeah.
we know we have the task force and the special teams that go out on different operations.
But it's just not effective, because, I mean, Fine Food was robbed mm-hmm. right down the street from the police station. So obviously the response time is not enough. The mm-hmm. criminals, it's obvious, very difficult to know where the criminals are going to be and at what point.
Yeah.
And your response time obviously is not quick enough to be able to catch them before they perpetrate a crime
mm-hmm.
or to be able to apprehend the criminals.
Yeah. I don't want to engineer the solution. They're exposed right. to do that.
Yeah.
But, you know, again, as a citizen, it's like, okay, so where is my National Security Council? You know why? I need to be hearing more about what's happening, and not just kind of, yeah, it's good to tell everybody stay calm.
Right.
And that's necessary. But at the same token, I want to see us being more proactive in response to this and getting more done.
And I think we have to demand it, because we are the ones who are being affected.
Mm-hmm.
Like, my children live a hop, skip, and a jump away from the sticket.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So I can't afford to just be calm about it.
Yeah. And then people are being also, we have entry into homes.
Yes.
That's been happening with people in their homes. So right. yeah, it's escalated to a point, or past a point, I would say, that we need to take serious action. Take it very seriously. Just before we step into 2017, another issue I had was increased cost of living and increased cost of doing business.
Yes.
One of the concerns I had, especially around business, is the increase in whether it was fees, taxes. The introduction of NHI was basically a new tax that came into effect. And, you know, whilst it has its purpose and it's a good thing, that it does affect the business person in regards to, you know, this is a cost, you know, that you have to carry mm-hmm. For operating business in the BVI.
Yeah.
You know, and then minimum wage went up by 50%,
mm-hmm.
and you know, the list can go on, especially if you're in the tourism sector. You know, the hotel tax is about to go up as well. So I think we need to look at balancing increasing revenue for the government through tax legislation, and how frequently it's done, and, you know, striking a balance with it, because we don't want it to become prohibitive to operate as a business. And that cost now translates into increased cost of living, because businesses have to get their revenue from someplace through their sales. And so I can't sell you my product at the same price that I sold you 2-3 years ago, because, you know, I just went up. My expenses went up on their own by, let's say, 10% as a figure, just throwing it out, you know.
Right.
So I think those are some of the things that I would like to see persons become more conscious of, because everybody's affected. Even if we think, oh, well, you know, that's the hotel tax, or, you know, not the restaurants, everything that's associated with that is going to be impacted either directly or indirectly.
And look at the result of when costs go up to business and they have to raise their prices. Mm-hmm. There's an increased call for persons to bring businesses from outside within the territory. Mm-hmm. There's more people going to shop online. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's more people going away to shop, which is a lot more money is being leaked from the economy. Mm-hmm. And I think you make a very valid point in terms of how to balance revenue with how to balance revenue for the government with having a thriving business sector, because mm-hmm. When you order stuff from online, that doesn't really help you with your employment. Mm-hmm. You know, when you go to shop in Miami or in St. Thomas, it doesn't necessarily help with your employment. Mm-hmm. Now, I understand the reasons for doing that, mm-hmm. and I'm placing responsibility on our government to find creative ways to be able to raise our revenue, mm-hmm. to be able to, because we need the revenue to operate.
Yeah, to do what they need to do, you know, as far as physical infrastructure, social infrastructure, and services that's only provided by government.
Right.
So, you know, they have their role to play in terms of the society and what their contribution is to be. But everybody depends on everybody, right?
But it's just a tough environment for businesses right now, because, mm-hmm. I mean, you have to compete against all the external forces. Mm-hmm. And people want sponsorship. People want employment.
Your due diligence as a community citizen.
Right. Yeah. And the truth is, government cannot employ everyone. Mm-hmm. So the businesses have an important role in employing persons, and people have to factor that into the equation when they choose to do business. And the government has to factor that into the equation as it pertains to the taxes that make it more difficult to do business.
Yeah, it's interesting. So those were my three, as far as leaving from 2016 going into 2017, those are things that definitely are going to be part of the equation, because, you know, financial management is always going to be a hot button topic, mm-hmm. and cost of living forever is going to be there, cost of doing business, you know, crime, let's relabel it and call it safety in your community.
Right.
You know, the safety, the level of safety that we feel that we have in our country as a result of different things. So going into 2017, I had this long list of things. I was like, yes, I want to see freedom of information legislation, environmental legislation. Some of this stuff came out of the speech from the throne 2016, yes. By the way. And elections reform and the business case for the airport project and all these other stuff. But, you know, it dawned on me. I was like, wait a minute. At the end of the day, all of these things would be covered in a national development strategy.
Yes.
And a national physical development plan.
Yes.
As far as what in the world are we doing with the BVI for the next 15, 20 years. Because it's important, I think, that we get out of this short-term mindset, because that's where I feel we're getting sucked into and becoming very reactionary to a lot of things, rather than being proactive and sitting down and planning. Okay, this is what we want to do with physical infrastructure. This is what needs to happen with the water system. This is what needs to happen with the road network. This is what needs to happen with sewage. So that you don't have never-ending projects or projects that start and stop. And because of that, the cost now, again, to the taxpayer is much more than it should be. Because now whenever a project stops and starts, it costs more to start it back up. And it's, you know, again, inflation just by itself,
right,
is going to drive the cost up, mm-hmm. to go back and finish a particular thing, especially when it comes around physical infrastructure. So that's all I want to see.
Yeah.
That's all I want to see this year. A national development strategy for the next 15, 20 years, telling me what is going to happen with my country.
And this is
where we're going, because then we can, from that now, I can see us sitting down and having the conversations around what we need to do with the economy. If we're going to get serious about agriculture, mm-hmm. and fishing, what is that going to look like?
Yeah.
Managing or marine tourism, and what needs to undergird that? as far as things like our environmental legislation that, again, we've been talking about for quite some time, probably going on 2 decades, mm-hmm. in regards to protecting our natural environment, you know?
Well, I agree with you completely in terms of how we approach governance and how we approach our development. Right now we have a situation, I think this is across party lines, mm-hmm. where ministers feel as though to justify re-election or to show that you're doing a good job, every minister has to have a project. Mm-hmm. And it's not even just about managing what we already have and making it work better. Mm-hmm. You have to come with some type of project. We have a project mentality. Mm-hmm. And every minister believes that, you know, he or she has to have one. But in a national development strategy, you know, you're basically looking at the areas of priority. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously you have to have a discussion about what the priorities are. From a holistic standpoint and over a long term, rather than a short term basis. But you see what the priorities are, and if this year or next 2-3 years we're only able to deal with this one particular thing, and in every other area we just focus on making it work better, more efficiently, mm-hmm. that's okay. And you don't have to feel as though we missed out doing something, or I don't have anything to show the voters. Mm-hmm. And with a national development strategy, this is something that we would expect the voters, the residents to participate in. Mm-hmm. Basically forecasting where we're going and what we're doing.
And that's where, that for me is where we need to pivot. You know, in terms of our political development, mm-hmm. because even when you go to talk about things like constitutional reform, mm-hmm. you have to have a long-term view as far as we're doing constitutional reform, not just for now, to say, well, we don't trust the governor, we don't know what they're up to, mm-hmm. you know, the leader of the opposition in the UK Parliament is speaking against us in terms of looking at direct rule, right. and all these different things. But again, it's not for now. Mm-hmm. Those decisions are for long term, and if we don't have a long term plan that it would feed into, then we can't really have a serious discussion around, you know, what we're doing with the country, where is the country going. And I think we're spending our children's future. Mm-hmm. You know, is would be how I would term it, because we're not thinking about sustainability. Remember when that was such a buzzword?
Yes.
Sustainable development.
Never went past the buzzword.
But again, it's like, what are, you know, what actions can we point towards? What decisions can we point towards that showing that, you know, this is in fact what we are striving towards, mm-hmm. in terms of the sustainable development of the country? And even more so where, you know, in the world, economic cycles will happen. You have recessions, you right. have surplus, you right. know, you will have surplus, you have deficit. So we have to manage ourselves in such a way that, you know, whether it's up or down, we're in a stable situation.
Absolutely.
Because we're planning and we're able to say, well, these are the projects that we're going to work on, and, you know, put systems in place as far as project management. You know me.
Yes.
It's always manager. About a plan. You need a plan. Even if I'm going to build a school, I mean, from the smallest project to the biggest one, you need to have some kind of plan.
Right.
So that way you know that you spend the money once. That's always my biggest thing, you know.
Yeah.
I need to spend the money once. Right. I don't care if I'm just building a sidewalk. I need to spend the money once.
Yeah, and something as simple as that. We spend money more than once.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And that means another sidewalk that's needed someplace else doesn't get built.
Right.
And people are, their lives are jeopardized because they only have to walk in the road.
Right.
And you know, the quality of life. That's really what it is for me
right.
at this junction. You know, it's all about the quality of life. I don't care what the grandiose promises are or what we're trying to do, but it has to be about what are we doing to improve the quality of life now and for the future.
Yeah, and there are some basics that we definitely have to deal with. You deal with you mentioned the sidewalks and the basic infrastructure. Mm-hmm. You know, we sidewalks are very
safe
important.
Roads, well-marked roads, lighted roads.
Things just like pulling out of a junction and being able to see
clearly
what's coming from the left or the right. Mm-hmm. I mean, those things are really important. One thing I would like to see in 2017 really is along the the lines of planning, which is, you know, we have to have a consensus, some type of consensus in the community as it pertains to certain issues. Mm-hmm. I would like to see across party lines, for instance, that we develop a consensus about, and this goes into the globalization thing, I'm not sure mm-hmm. if I'm preempting you.
No, go ahead.
But how are we going to manage globalization?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what levels, you can say, would we be willing to go as it pertains to protectionism?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what industries do we want to protect for our locals?
So you're talking in terms of having that a nationalistic attitude towards for your economic development.
Right. Okay. We have some type of policy as pertain, because we know in the BVI that we rely a lot mm-hmm. on international business companies. You know, that's what the financial services is all about. Mm-hmm. We don't expect anybody to say in the financial services sector that we don't want any businesses from outside to be able to do business in the BVI.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we do here. But taxiing, for instance, we've said we only want locals, belongers, mm-hmm. BVI landers to be able to
taxi drivers.
Mm-hmm. What other industries do we want to be able to protect for our people? Under what conditions?
Mm-hmm.
Under what conditions will we allow persons to enter into partnerships? What type of partnerships? Mm-hmm. You know, how you know, in terms of shares, do we want 60-40, 49-51?
Mm-hmm.
And this is a real discussion we have to have, because right at the end of the year, we got news about, I believe it's Rotown Wholesale,
mm-hmm.
Majority shares being sold to Northwest, I believe is the name of the company that
mm-hmm.
owns Cossulus.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a big deal. For a lot of business owners, it's a big deal for a lot of consumers. Some mm-hmm. consumers are excited about it.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
we're hoping for the best.
We're hoping for the best.
We'll see what happens. Because I had that conversation probably last week in terms of, you know, there's so many things that, from a business standpoint, that, you know, North South Indians get up and these Northwest Indians get up and make a decision like this without
right.
crunching the numbers and
of
figuring
course.
Out, you know, what direction is they're going to use, the strategy and all the rest of it. So, yeah, I told them, I said, I'm going to wait to see.
Yeah.
I have to wait and see, because we're going to make some assumptions that might turn out to be wrong assumptions in terms of what could happen.
Right.
Or we know what we would like to see happen.
Right.
As far as the cost of food.
Of course.
Again, going back to the cost of living.
Yeah.
Being more affordable, but yeah, it's gonna be interesting. But you know, I slightly have a different view from what you're saying in terms of the protectionism, and it's something where I see the role of government to empower
right.
its people in regards to going into any level of business
right.
within your own economy.
Yeah.
And you know, whether it's providing the training in terms of schooling, training institutes, you see a lot in, especially in the other Caribbean countries, where they made that a priority.
Right.
So it wasn't just about the traditional education system, but you had a lot of, but it was technical training institutes to
yes.
make sure that they could be employed basically in or outside their economy.
Right.
You
well,
know?
I agree with that.
And having that skill set, because what I have found in terms of working with businesses is that the exposure now in terms of learning how to do business mm-hmm. and the mechanics and the fundamentals of business, we're mm-hmm. not being exposed to as locals.
Right.
So we're at a disadvantage, even if we have interest in certain things. Because,
right.
you know, things like with the charter boat industry. I remember there was talk about restrictions there with trade licenses
mm-hmm.
at one point. But again, what was done to ensure now that Virgin Islanders were in a position to enter into that industry, whether it's as support personnel, mechanics, boat mechanics, you know, these different types of areas, apart from being boat captains. And even that,
and we dropped
we're
the ball.
Behind on.
We
yeah.
have to say we dropped the ball when it, as it pertains to all those things. So I agree
yeah.
with you completely. We have to empower our people to be able to participate in these industries
mm-hmm.
and not just think that restricting anybody
yeah,
else
that's not gonna help.
Is going to help us.
No,
so I would like to see a strategy that would include educating and training our people.
It has to be a holistic.
A holistic standpoint. Mm-hmm. And actually, you end up hurting the economy if you restrict people from being able to do business within the economy without providing an alternative.
Yeah. I think that's an overreach of government. Because it's like you're responsible for regulating. So you decide whether or not a particular business entity qualifies for a trade license.
Right.
And, you know, kind of let the economy run, take care of itself from there.
Yeah, from a market standpoint.
But, you know, and if there are certain concessions you want to give to locals versus overseas investors, those are the types of things now I would like to see us take into consideration.
Right.
Because, again, it's about empowering a level playing field. I have less access to capital than the billionaire coming in that wants to start a business.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm in a position where I can have access to that capital because, you know, all banking regulations are such that it frees that up, you know, in order to build businesses and expand existing businesses. And, you know, that those are along more the lines I like to see us moving, because, you know, just doing the stuff with saying, you know, we have restrictions on certain things or trying to think, because my whole thing is nationalize the whole economy.
Right.
That's you know, we spend, we're saying we have $1 billion GDP.
Mm-hmm.
So we're saying that we have expenditure and revenue in the country in 1 year of almost $1 billion.
Right.
$300 million of that is government spending.
Right.
You know, where who's
million.
Controlling the rest?
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? So it's to say no as a government, listen, over the next 10 years, this is the game plan.
Mm-hmm.
We understand our industries that exist. These are the job opportunities that are there. These are the business opportunities that are there. So we're looking at both the business side of it and the employment and making sure that your people are in a position. So, you know, entities or agencies like the National Business Bureau, I mean, they have to be like top priority.
Yeah.
Because those are the resource centers that government should be providing to enable anybody to
it's almost peripheral to what it is we're doing right now.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't actually disagree too much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think we pretty much in this in the same realm.
Yeah.
Because let's take something like chicken, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
I believe, and I've been saying it for a long time, that we can produce our own chicken here in the BVI, because in terms of what's required, I don't see what's the barrier for us.
No. They're not there like they were 10 years ago.
But there's a real difference in terms of saying, okay, we're going to stop foreign chicken from coming into the BVI and we haven't put anything in place,
exactly,
to supply it. So I would like to see us take measures actually to increase our supply, and then, you know, you can take a look at
start the local production and build it up.
You start the local production and then you take a look at the situation and try to see, you know, what you can do to, as you say, incentivize locals, or perhaps maybe help locals we spoke about the cost of doing business. How can we ensure that locals can produce chicken and things like that as something that's commensurate with what's expected internationally?
And get to the point of even export.
Absolutely.
There's, you know, the sky isn't the limit. Space is the limit, really.
Right.
You understand? So we really have to think outside the box, even when we talk about the national development strategy, and go from there. Joanne, we're out of time.
So much more to speak. We didn't even get to speak about energy.
We are going to have a part two for sure.
Yeah.
We're going to have a part two. Because there's so much, I think, in terms of setting the stage for this year and putting things out there and then kind of going through the different conversations as far as breaking it down. We're going to get to it. So
I agree with you with the plan. Let's start planning.
Yeah, that's a good place to start, right?
Yeah.
That's a good place to start. So thank you again for coming through.
Thank you for having me.
We look forward to seeing you very soon. You've been tuned in to the Vigilante Dialogues. I'm your host, Shayna Smith, saying thank you for being here. And if you just tuned in, you can see us again on Sundays at 3:30 p.m. or check us out on YouTube on the Vigilante's Dialogue channel. And I am saying, as always, straight into this new year, let's continue the change in conversation for a better Virgin Islands.